Welcome to At the Cottage with me, Chef D. This year we've teamed up with Gypsy Wind Coaches and Culinary Tourism Alliance, and we're keeping it local. On today's show, we're meeting Chef Sean, who has two locations, one in Collingwood, one in Thornbury. We're meeting Agatha from Feast On, and we're going to be cooking over a real wood grill. Won't you join me? I'm here with Agatha from the Culinary Tourism Alliance, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Now, you guys have started the Feast On, not started, but you've been, the Feast On program has been one of your brainchilds.
Yeah, so we, 6 years ago now, wow, time flies, we started this program as essentially a reaction to the industry telling us that there was no authenticity left in local food in this province and that people were doing it but not necessarily actually acting on it or talking about it and not necessarily living it, and so we worked with a bunch of over 40 local food organizations in the province and the Ministry of Agriculture to essentially create a set of criteria that restaurants could participate in to prove that they're putting where their money where their mouth is in Ontario. Mm-hmm.
So then to be a Feast On designated restaurant, mm-hmm. We are. I know
that's
Sean,
true.
Whose backyard we're in, is.
And, also true.
And he's also, you know, I think he's a poster child.
He's definitely OG Feast On Chef. He might have been like the fourth person to ever apply for the program. First to certify.
Yeah.
Don't tell the folks in Northern Algonquin I said that because they were actually first. But he's definitely OG. Mm-hmm. The community's grown so much. In the first year, we had 20 chefs and restaurants in the program, and now we're at over 150, and that's growing exponentially every year.
Every month. I get an email every month and an update of what's going on, and you always see, like, there was, like, the last one was 10 new places.
Exactly. It's exciting.
Okay, so how, if you're a viewer, and if you're at a restaurant, how do you become Feast On certified?
Oh, okay, let's talk about paperwork.
Okay, because you know all us chefs love doing paperwork.
Yeah, you love paperwork. So essentially what happens is you express interest and we have these forms that we mm-hmm. send you. You open your books to us, you tell us where you spend your money,
yep.
And as long as 25% of where you spend your money is in Ontario, both on booze and on food,
yep.
You can be a part of the program. We then call up the producers that you say you work with and we say, hey, Shifty says he works with you and he spends this much money. Is that true? And they'll either be like, yeah, totally. He actually spends more. Or they'll be like, Chef D, who the hell is Chef D? Click. And if that happens, obviously they don't pass. But usually people are honest, and they verify that, and then you get to be a part of the program.
You know, when we first started doing this whole Chef D thing, mm-hmm. and this is going back when we did the YouTube channel and everything like that, my whole goal was to kind of focus on local people and local places and that. So then when I finally, you know, kind of figured out what we could do and we had an actual, you know, building instead mm-hmm. of just doing all the catering, and being able to claim that we're Feast On certified, that was like just a really near and dear something to my heart. So I just think what you guys are doing is absolutely fantastic. How is that for buttering you up?
Oh, I feel buttered. I feel breaded and buttered and soon to be deep fried.
So now, you know, you get this program going, mm-hmm. you're doing a really great job of it, and then we have this little thing called a pandemic come through.
Yeah, this tiny little terrible thing happened.
How's that affecting, you know, I know how it's affecting some people in my industry, like, you know, that are close to my home. How's it affecting in other places in Ontario?
You know, it's a mixed bag. What we're finding is because we work with destinations across the province and then we work with individual restaurants, mm-hmm. restaurants that regularly source from Ontario and have relationships with their farmers and know their farmer's name are doing a little bit better mm-hmm. because the distribution networks are a little bit more solidified and they're built for things like this. They're resilient. And those kinds of relationships, people are giving each other breathing room and space and working together to succeed. But we hear a lot of terrible stories as well about the industry and, you know, not being able to pay their staff or stay open, and how even if they're able to open just their patio, for instance, that's not good enough. Most restaurants that I work with need to have 75% capacity just to break even.
Mm-hmm.
And so just having a few patio tables up front, it's it's not enough. It's not enough to save our industry and keep that beautiful, robust, dynamic dining culture we have in this province.
And we do that, like, you know, even just in starting with the tour that we've done, you know, the last couple of days and that, is that, you know, just seeing from, you know, a Best Western hotel that has a really cool young chef that wants to just grow it. You know, then we were in Hockley Valley, you know, and we're here and that, and I just see a little bit of the resilience, you know, each place that we go to has done something different
exactly.
to make it go. Now, not everyone can have all the staff that they had maybe, you know, 6 months ago, but they're making it work with some smaller staff, but also, what you said too about the farmers is in our case too, there's like Tim Berry, Berry's Asparagus, you know, Matthew Moss, and that they're bringing the product right to us. Third generation organics has been absolutely fantastic with us.
Nice.
So now going forward, where do you see, like, how are we going to grow this? I know this is a really loaded question, you know.
Let's go. I'm ready. What's the question?
How are you feeling? How can the Culinary Tourism Alliance help the industry push it back out there?
Wow, that is a very loaded question. Well, we're working on a couple pretty cool things. One of the things we're most excited about is we're launching this Great Taste of Ontario road trip program in the fall, which is pretty exciting. I've heard about a concept like that. And basically what we're doing is encouraging people to travel in the province and rediscover those hyper-local places that they might have forgot about. The fact is there's so many amazing, beautiful places in this province that people either think are too close or they forget about or they discount because they're close by and they're not exotic or foreign or tropical, but they're beautiful and wonderful. And I think the silver lining of all of this is that people are going to rediscover this province and there's going to be more opportunity for people to open the kinds of businesses that Feast On loves so much and supports.
So the Culinary Road Trip, right?
Yeah.
Culinary Road Trip. Look for it in the fall. Be part of it, you know, spend big, spend local. You're helping your neighbor. So in the midst of social distancing, this is kind of working out the best for me because all my guests are actually doing all the hard work. I want to introduce a really close friend and a really amazing chef, Sean Emmonson, the Crow Variety and the Bruce Wine Bar here in Thornbury. Yeah. Brother, I know we've talked about this, trying to arrange this for the last couple of years. It's great to have you on the show.
Thanks for, you know, reaching out. And it's going to be a fantastic day.
I mean, I know. We've picked the perfect weather.
We started off, it was a little cloudy this morning, but at this point it looks like it's blown over. So, you know, we should have some fun today.
I think we should, because not only we do have the beautiful Crown Verde right here that we'll be cooking on.
Absolutely.
But because I think we're all pyromaniacs in our, you know, previous lives and all that, right?
Fire, food, and knives. They all seem to go together, right?
So we have a wood grill that we're going to go down to and do some amazing Nutrifarms chicken and ribeyes down there. How did you get into this crazy business?
You know, I kind of started off loving food. You know, my grandfather was the president of the Ontario Beekeeper Association. My other side of my grandparents had a big kind of market garden and that. And I started as a dishwasher kind of at 13. I never really left. And it was, you know, a really kind of great output as a kid. You get to sit there and once again, fire, food, and knives.
Right.
You get a little bit of that pyro kind of in you. And, you know, what other better way to take and bring, you know, everybody together and that friends and or family and share a meal. So, you know, it's pretty awesome that, you know, 27 years later, I'm still in the kitchen and still having fun behind the stove. So.
Yeah, and I can see that when we come into the restaurant, is absolutely fantastic. So we have some third generation organic pork tenderloin that you're going to be grilling on the grill.
Yeah.
We have some beets, I think, over there. Some zucchini that was your purchase, and some eggplant.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've got some great Ontario produce right now. You know, we're just hitting that kind of stride.
Yes.
Finally kind of seeing it flood the grocery stores between beans, zucchini, you know, eggplant. We got some lovely...
I know, the beans, I've been eating them back.
It's a great snack. I mean, you know, my bean plants, if I can keep the kids away from them, do pretty well. Otherwise, the kids just sit there and they snack all afternoon.
Right.
But, you know, we've got some beautiful produce, you know, around us. You know, Ontario's got some, you know, amazing producers, and you know, we're happy to sit there and be able to really focus and highlight what they kind of produce.
And that's kind of always been your go-to, right?
It has been. You know, like, why take and look outside of our own kind of province? You know, we've got so much available, you know, and throughout the wintertime and that, we can always do canning and pickling and that type of thing. And it really kind of, you know, allows you to kind of eat with seasons and that as well.
And when we come to your place, a lot of the charcuterie boards that you create, is a lot of your pickling is all over that.
It is, you know, what better way to take and really highlight great Ontario produce, you know, throughout the year, and pickling and charcuterie boards. You know, great to kind of start a meal and you sit down and kind of great conversation pieces. You know, as we kind of go through and that, you know, right now I think it's a little bit more challenging with social distancing, but, it, you know, it, still sitting down and having something that you can converse over and really take your time and kind of ease into a meal, it's an awesome way to start.
Perfect. So you're going to get started on your side. I'm going to get doing some vegetables, some onions, a little bit of wilted beet tops, because don't forget, you can use the whole vegetable, some beans, and we're going to use some of your Thornlow butter because I stole that off you. And I know Jason Purcell, who's a Cooley Pristine Oils, check them out. They can deliver right to your door.
Yeah, and some beautiful product from them, too. They do amazing kind of cold press oils and vinegars and some really great legumes and that as well. Their lentils and cranberry kidney beans, split peas, you know, they really got a wide range of products.
100%.
And, you know, fantastic kind of suppliers, so.
Let's keep cooking.
Yeah. Get this.
Okay, don't eat a bean and try and talk at the same time. Beautiful grass-raised butter. You just love how beautiful yellow this is. True natural. We have to put a little bit of butter in our pan. So we're putting the beets on.
Beets on, just a little bit of oil, just to kind of help conduct that heat, and that way they don't dry out. We'll give them a little bit of seasoning just to start. And then, you know, after we can always toss them with a little bit of honey and,
exactly,
and that type of thing, maybe a little vinegar.
Mm-hmm.
Give them some nice brightness and that.
And you don't need to put it in foil. You can actually do it right on the top of the grill, maybe a little bit lower side of the grill, but they work out beautifully. And they're, like you said, they're just coming right in. All the vegetables are coming right in.
Yeah. Well, we're starting to get those first of the season ones, and just, you know, end up being so sweet, and especially when you're grilling and roasting them, taking and really caramelizing down those sugars. They're fantastic.
Eggplant, nothing better grilled, you know. I love it. Pizza, salad, everything. Make it into, you know, even a spread.
Ah, baba ganoush is lovely. You know, one of my favorite things to do is just even like a grilled ratatouille with it. Take some zucchini and eggplant, throw some peppers on too, a little bit of blistered tomatoes.
Yep.
It's absolutely gorgeous.
I might have some blistered tomatoes for you, Chef.
Awesome. We'll take it. The tomatoes that are coming out of the hothouses right now down in Leamington and that.
Aren't they amazing? You know, like, you've been in, you're kind of my vintage and been around for a while. It's neat to see that not only can they have them all year round now, that they actually taste like tomatoes.
They've still got flavor. And,
yep,
and really taking and developing, you know, the sugars and that, it's been amazing. You know, we think of, you know, Ontario kind of being, you know, kind of cold and dreary during the wintertime, mm-hmm, and just be able to take and still get some amazing kind of fresh product.
Right, and years ago we couldn't do that.
No. That technology has really kind of accelerated forward on how we grow and how we're able to eat throughout the course of the season.
So when you were thinking about feast dining, because, you know, I heard that you were like number 4 in getting signed up for the program, like, how did that come about?
It was actually one of my buddies, Ryan Crawford, down at Backhouse, which is now Rufino's,
yep,
had contacted me about it and said, hey, you really got to kind of check this out. You're already, you know, so involved within the food community in our area and really taking and focusing on what was local and that, and, you know, building that relationships within the community. It just kind of made sense,
mm-hmm,
you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great way talk about our story more and really kind of let people know that what we were doing it, I want to say ethically and as well, you know, actually walking the walk.
Yep.
Right? You know, for a long time, I think we got away from where our food came from and that, and, you know, kind of making sure that what we said we were doing, we're actually doing. Mm-hmm. You know, putting local on your menu or organic and those types of things ended up being a lot of kind of buzzwords mm-hmm. for a lot of cases. And this was a way to kind of, you know, really certify and say, okay, hey, we are who we are and what we're doing is actually, you know, being followed through on.
100%.
Yeah, and it's been a great program, you know. The things that you can access through it, things like Terroir Symposium, going through and having the marketing background as well and getting on these kind of programs, you know, really takes and checks what you're doing and holds everybody accountable.
100%. So now we have this on our grill. I think we should go down to the fire grill and get our chicken and ribeye going. What do you think?
I think it's a fabulous idea. I think that fire is just coming down to a point where we're getting that nice ember.
When you don't have the people there to support you that you know you should, your world kind of like spirals. But United Way has been the biggest change coming into high school. Having the ability to help kids succeed is so important.
Looking for the best way to get the Major League Baseball games you want to watch? Rogers Super Sports Pack has you covered. With MLB Extra Innings, you'll have a premium ticket to out-of-market regular season games with all games available in HD. Don't miss the action from the games you want from both the American and National Leagues. MLB Extra Innings, part of the Super Sports Pack. For only $35.95 a month, Rogers customers get all this for one all-inclusive price. Order using your remote starting on channel 431 or visit rogers.com today.
It's so inspiring to know that there's people out there that are willing to help people who've gone the situation that I've gone through. Because of United Way, I'm able to stand in front of you today with a good job that I can actually make something of myself.
Crown Verity is one of our sponsors, and it's always great. They gave me some amazing barbecues, but I think my favorite one is a wood-fired grill that you've seen and we use. So I come to Sean's place, and you have like the pit and ready. But there's a story behind this.
Yeah, so my grandfather made it like years and years ago for corn roast.
Yeah.
And over the years, we've kind of added a couple other apparatuses and that. Mm-hmm. We've got a grill, we've got a kind of a couple big cast iron cauldrons, and then we've got a big flat top kind of plancha.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's become a really kind of versatile piece of equipment for taking and doing, you know, outdoor cooks, whether it's weddings and that type of thing, or even just, you know, fun in the backyard.
You know, just having Agatha from Feast On come and, you know, hey, we're going to cook some really cool food for her.
Yeah. No, and she, you know, she's been known to build a fire or two herself.
Okay.
You know, years ago we did terroir together and did the rural retreat, and, you know, she was up at 5 o'clock in the morning starting fires to get ready for it. And, you know, I think she misses cooking a little bit now and again
mm-hmm.
and being in the kitchen.
You know, once it's in your blood, it never goes away.
No, it's true. It's, you know. As I was kind of saying before, you know, what better way to kind of bring people together than over a really fantastic meal?
100% on that. This is really cool, brother. This is really cool. Like, I almost feel like we're back to native times, you know?
Just taking, we can wrap it all and give it a little smoke.
100%, right? 100%. So I seasoned the chicken just again
awesome.
For social distancing. We're all good that way. And you have some...
I got some butcher hooks.
Okay.
So we'll try and hang a couple of those and mm-hmm. just do a really slow roast on them.
Yep. So in real time, this would probably be about 2 hours, right?
Yeah. It, you know.
Or about six beers?
Six beers.
Yeah.
Maybe eight, depending on, you know, how hot of the day it is.
Okay.
It, you know, I think it's, what, about 32 degrees today?
100%.
So, you know, they might evaporate a little faster. Mm-hmm. We'll see. Yeah, I'll get some chicken on here.
Okay, perfect.
We'll see how we do.
And not only can you just do, like, we're doing the ribeye, we're doing the whole chickens, but, you know, you could do the pork tenderloin this way. You could do duck, you know, wherever you want to go with it. Take it and just love it, you know, and try it. And, you know, if the first one doesn't work out, try it again. It's not a bad thing. It's not rocket science, you know, and we still learn by all our mistakes. I wish I could say I've perfected those, but I haven't.
I think, you know, mistakes in cooking sometimes create some of the best food
100%.
Experience as well. That guy.
So these are pasture-raised chicken. So amazing, amazing. We were up north at a ATV conference. And Ted Reeder comes up, and we know all Teddy, who just loves doing this. And we had big logs in the middle of the fire, and we cooked everything on the big logs beside the fire. It was incredible. Like, I don't have any more hair on my legs at all because of
that. You know, there's something very natural about taking and just using wood and going slow.
100%.
You know, the flavor that you're able to take and develop off it is spectacular.
So I think now we go maybe have a glass of the Featherstone, you know, Cab Franc there.
And relax a little bit.
Yeah, and chillax, and we'll come back to it.
Absolutely. It's going to take a little bit of time.
Perfect. So as you can see, we've turned our beef once already, and do another quarter turn here. And you have the big shovel.
Well, you know, redistribute some of the coal base.
Yep.
and make sure that, you know, we're getting nice even heat. Anytime that we're taking it and cooking with wood, you know, it's not as even as your gas barbecue.
100%, 100%.
And that, so we've got to take in and be a little bit more involved with kind of the cooking process. But we started off with a fair amount of wood, and it's kind of started to burn away, and we've got a great kind of coal bed, but we still need to kind of manage that a little bit and make sure that, you know, we're getting well-distributed heat, and that way we don't end up with kind of scorched parts, right?
100%.
Wouldn't want to take and disrespect that beautiful pieces of meat there.
Is there the wood that you're burning right now, is it anything in particular, or?
This wood is kind of just mixed hardwood. At the restaurant, in our wood oven and that, we use primarily cherry. Mm-hmm. We find it, it gives a really good burn, and, you know, imparts a little bit of flavor. Our wood oven generally cranks at around 900 degrees, so it cooks a Neapolitan style pizza in about 2 minutes. But here, yeah, it's mixed hardwood. There's some maple in there. There's a little bit of cherry in that, but it's kind of just a mixed bag.
Exactly, and get what, you know, you can find and go from there, experiment with it. You know, I do have a great wood supplier, all kiln dried hardwood. We get a little bit more ash with ours because that's what he's getting right now.
Yeah.
And every once in a while, he'll surprise me with some cherry, and it's just heaven.
It's a nice treat to get that cherry. It burns so well. But yeah, I mean, as long as you've got a good hardwood, for the most part, you know, you're going to get a good burn and a good heat out of it, which is kind of what you're looking for.
And, you know, we might have brought out the, you know, Yeti,
well,
you know, grapefruit rattler, a little bit less alcohol in it, so, you know, we can kind of cruise control our way.
Cruise control, but it's still delicious, and especially on this hot day.
And yeah, I don't think we could pick any hotter days for the, right?
I think it's 34 degrees right now without the Humidex.
Well, we're going to continue grilling. We'll come back in just a minute. Fast forward about 3 hours of, you know, having some nice beverages from our good friends at Warlow Brewery. A beautiful backyard, Chef Sean. This is absolutely fantastic back here.
Thank you.
This is just
a
like
a lot of fun.
Yeah. Your wood pot. We still got the fire going.
Still got the fire going.
Do you think we're going to do some more?
Well, it's been known to happen. Just keep throwing stuff on. It'll be fun.
So we have our beautiful three generations organics pork tenderloin. Our little ratatouille, this is the Ontario ratatouille, so we used some fresh beans from your garden, carrots, some zucchini and eggplant, a little bit of onions that I got at the Owen's Hill Market, and nothing better than a beautiful, rare prime rib done on a wood grill. It doesn't get much better than that. And you're solid here, young man.
We got some Ontario corn right now. So, you know, like everything's kind of coming into season, and that first of the Ontario corn right now has been beautiful.
Yeah.
The sweetness that's coming out of it is just
that's right.
Awesome.
The heat this year is just, it's lovely. And then, of course, our chickens here at the end, not to be outdone, a little bit of chimichurri sauce. And, of course, some of your beautiful pickling that you do on a regular basis at the restaurant.
Yeah. We got some beans, some morel mushrooms from the spring of last year. And then we've got an apple compote and then some house-made Chardonnay mustard.
Oh, I can hardly wait. I know how good his mustard is. And then, of course, our good friends from Featherstone just kind of keeping us in some wine.
There's a couple of others.
Just enjoying that wine for myself here.
Again, feast on Culinary Tourism Alliance.
That's us.
Right? And, you know, again, look for it on menus and that, right?
Look for it on menus, on restaurant websites, on the front door of a lot of places as you walk up. You can see the logo. It's a great way to basically support restaurants who are supporting our agricultural industry and people who are going that extra mile to do that work.
Also, too, if you go on your website.
Yep, OntarioCulinary.com. You can find a full list of restaurants currently in the program, as well as fun itineraries and ideas for day trips that are safe and exciting and, of course, delicious all throughout the province.
And there's something coming up this fall that we're going to be doing?
Yeah, the Great Taste of Ontario road trip. Look for it in the Globe and Mail and online and follow along. It's going to be a really delicious time.
Social media.
And on Shifty's social media sites. Hashtag feast on.
Love how you got it. Hey, brother, I can't say thank you enough for spending some, you know, many kitchen hours this morning to do this. And like I said, your backyard's perfect for this. Continue doing what you're doing. You do such a great job of it at both restaurants. The Crowbar in Collingwood, right?
Crowbar and Variety in Collingwood and Bruce Wine Bar in Thornbury.
Just quickly, because you've done just a little bit of change with COVID, how can our viewers come and see you?
So we've got our bodega and bottle shop open kind of during the day. You can check our website and social media for kind of open hours on that. And then we still offer our wood oven pizza and kind of ocean-wise specials and things like that throughout the evenings. And you can order online and or over the phone.
So it's takeout, you're not open for sit-down?
Right now, we've decided to take and hold off and not take and do in-house dining just because our space is so intimate, and we really want to make sure that when we do welcome guests back, we're offering them, you know, the exceptional service that they've come to know and love.
Perfect.
And if that fails, we can show up in his yard, right?
100%. Just take this turn, and you're here. Hey, it's been a lot of fun. Again, tell her it's the way that you like it. Again, if you're not liking your beef rare like what we like it, take it a little bit longer. I've been cooking for my parents for over 40 years. They still love it medium well. I can't get it over it. Le Feast on, fresh Ontario produce, support local. Until next time, I'm Chef D.